Let's welcome Dr. Ying Zhu, professor of cinema studies, and she's the chair of the media culture at the College of Staten Island, CUNY. She's a leading scholar on Chinese cinema and media studies, and her publications have appeared in many prominent journals. She's edited book volumes and website blogs in U.S., China, and Europe. Dr. Zhu is a recipient of many fellowships, recently an American Council of Learned Societies fellowship. She is the author and editor of 8 books, including 2 Billion Eyes, The Story of China Central TV, The New Press 2012. Dr. Zhu's research monograph, Chinese Cinema During the Era of Reform, The Ingenuity of the System, is considered by critics as a path-breaking book that initiated the study of Chinese cinema within the framework of political economy. Her research monograph, Television in Post-Reform China, Serial Drama, Confucian Leadership, and the Global Television Market, together with 3 edited book volumes, she led TV China, TV Drama in China, and Comparative Studies of Chinese and U.S. Television, pioneered the subfield of Chinese television studies. Aside from her scholarly pursuits, Dr. Zhu also produces current affairs documentary films, including Google versus China and Tonight China, From Cartier to Confucius. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Ying Zhu. Thank you.
Well, the documentary is about the revival of Chinese classics learning at, you know, elite Chinese university. In this case, in particular, the film was shot at Fudan University, so really it features a group of Fudan University students. It follows these students who regularly attend a book club. It's a private book club where they recite classical Chinese Confucius texts, such as Analects and also the Book of Poetry, and then attempts to pass out the original meanings of such texts and figure out the contemporary ramifications of the connections between the texts and the contemporary situation. And let's sit back and hope you enjoy it. And afterwards, I look forward to spirited conversation. Thank you. Up each other by opening the dialogue to the floor. And if you have any questions, then let's get started.
First question, why is the professor, they study in the professor's home, the discipline of that professor is sociologist?
Yes, a sociologist, he's a...
Why? Because I heard that Fudan University has a very big philosophy department, but it's supposed to be guided by a philosopher, a Chinese scholar in Chinese song. Why is...
All right, Professor Tsun is in the sociology department, but really he studied a lot. He studied a lot of the traditional Chinese culture, Chinese history as well. And this is a private club. It's not affiliated with the university itself, so it's not part of the requirement for students to go. And this is every Friday, actually. Every Friday, this group of students would come instead of going out to party and so on and to the restaurant and socializing. They would choose to come to the professor's home down this traditional, some of them, you know, down this traditional outfit and sitting in a very interesting traditional way. So it's, you know, for me it was very kind of eye-opening experience, and I learned quite a bit from these students.
I'm just curious about the understanding of modernization that was brought up here and there. And I think traditionally in history we understand that modernization is actually based on westernization, the trend of becoming more Western and developing into more robust economic infrastructure based on capitalist society. However, I'm just wondering whether, and this is a thought that I've been having for a while, whether modernization has a unique standard that's separate from westernization, and apart from that, maybe the Chinese society is redefining what modernization means and setting up a new standard by, let's say, 2020, and then creating new dialogues or the discourse of modernization, or changing the direction of what it means.
Right. Modernization.
Oh, no, I was going to say, because there seems to be a lot of fear about modernization, so according to students.
I'm not sure it's it. I think, you know, part of the dichotomy is between tradition and modernity, and this is one of the threads. And the other thing is about the struggle was the division between the so-called, you know, Western thoughts and Chinese Eastern thoughts, as if, you know these both of these thinking are more or less kind of adopted a very essentialistic approach. On the other hand, as you can see, the predominant themes, you know, to me, in my throughout my encounter with this group of students, is really the question of the applicability of Western practices, a tradition, or Western thinking in China, in contemporary China. And of course, the documentary did not capture the earlier Westernization movement, you know, starting all the way back into the 1990s. We talk about May 4th generation. And the other thing, now much has been discussed, I think, about China's political infights and ideological factions. You know, to the left, there is a political camp that, you know, advocates re-centralization and a return to a more egalitarian socialist past, right? And then to the right, you have the kind of liberal camp that pushes for political reform and further marxization. And meanwhile, I think this is, you know, the kind of a third ideological camp that has quietly emerged, distancing itself from both the extreme left and the extreme right for their perceived irrelevance to Chinese cultural tradition and their, quote, misguided allegiance to Western models, as one of the students in the documentary elaborate somewhat, that, you know, this the kind of Marxist model to the left and liberal democratic model to the right. So as she told me, that the third camp upon which she comfortably rests or resides, seeks wisdom and remedies from traditional Chinese culture, of course, here. And this group really focuses on Confucius culture in addressing China's contemporary social ills, including the kind of perpetual corruption and, of course, the skyrocketing wealth gap. I guess the question really is, the two questions, you know, to me are very important, which is why the revival of Confucianism at this particular juncture, right? Is this revival a state-orchestrated effort, or rather a grassroots bottom-up effort? You know, as you can tell by a glimpse from bits and pieces of interview here, it seems that there is a kind of a dynamic grassroots movement that really confronting this overwhelming Marxization and the kind of a wealth gap, huge wealth gap, and people are really they're confronted with this reality, and they wanted to look for solutions. So they really started to look back into the Chinese history and so on, hopefully, you know, in the hope that there might be some wisdoms that they can learn in coping with the reality. And now, so the turn to Chinese cultural tradition reflects the kind of a bottom-up anxiety and then the fear and about Chinese society's loss of moral grounding. And to the students, group of students in particular, I think, you know, the book club has provided functioned as a sanctuary away from the kind of jitter of increasingly mercenary Chinese society, and which explains why at the very end of this documentary, the Chinese student, you know, proclaims that, you know, what really matters is the book learning, not the reality, the practicalities of, you know, very specific perspective, narrow perspectives from different angles and so on. And so so that's, I think, what I kind of take away from during the process of producing this documentary, during my encounter with this group of students. Yes.
So the question is more some, it's a nice problem to have, because I think perhaps the upper class, middle class, to have enough will consider these questions. But for the vast majority of the poor in China, I mean, is it even a concern? Like, I'm not even there to be concerned about this moral decay. I don't have enough. So is it, and I want it to do better. I want the society to be more modernized, because then I can have a piece of the pie. Right? So it's a expensive problem for people to consider, for those who already have it.
It's a very interesting perspective.
I don't think those students they are very poor, and they are very upset from the tone of the document. They are in the very bottom of the Chinese society.
There can't be the very bottom.
Well,
I think these questions. One of the girls, actually, the young lady was my classmate in Wuhan University.
Oh,
she
really?
Graduated from Wuhan University Philosophy Department. I was there in 2005, so we knew each other very well. And then she graduated from Wuhan, took the examination, go to Fudan, do Fudan University. Uh-huh. Her family.
Most of the students.
It's not very bottom. It's because they become a doctor student, right? But still, it's very hard. They will become middle class. But that's, in that sense, it's not in the very bottom. But still, their family and their relatives, they are in the very bottom.
Right. Most of the students we interviewed in this group are from villages, local villages, rural villages. The gentleman who show us the picture of, you know, her village is from a very poor place in China. Yeah,
the film is quite interesting, and I will ask you a dumb question, because I was when I first heard about the Confucius Institutes all over the world, and some of my friends and colleagues here, is this a government, why did they choose Confucius, and is it actually a state type of aspiring or something like that? Chinese and so forth, and then I thought, how could they choose somebody like Lu Xun or somebody like that? And then when I was, when I watched the documentary, of course they have a different point of view. They're actually studying, but I don't think they study Confucius Institutes all over the world. Do they really?
No. I don't think, Confucian Institute has nothing to do with, Confucianism. It is just a very convenient label for Chinese language. Yeah.
I mean, if the students are fairly serious, but then the government is using it to symbolize something, right?
It's just a very convenient kind of a shortcut, taking a shortcut, say, this is a Chinese culture. This is a Chinese culture, because we all know, Confucianism, okay, it's part of it. So the Confucian Institute really isn't about Chinese philosophy. It really is about Chinese culture and language learning. And they have a different kind of a mission. And it would be interesting to actually teach Confucianism, and it should be interesting, actually. So that gets back to the question is this kind of revival a state-orchestrated effort? Which, based on my interview with the students, is not. Because the state actually was very cautious. The state said, no, we don't want to do that. Because to the state, don't forget, until this day, a Marxist, a socialist ideology, state is still the party ideology, the mainstream ideology. So the question is whether one can reconcile Marxism with Confucianism. And that's part of things that the student asked about, and this is nothing new. The Chinese, the CCP had tried very hard to localize Marxism since day one, right? Since they adopted this kind of a Marxism philosophy, ideology, and the question is really whether how the two, let's talk about, entertain whether what are the similarities between Confucianism and Marxism, and what are the differences? Maybe you can tell me what might be the similarities between these two strains of thought.
One is economic determinism, the other one is relational determinism.
Right. Okay, so you're more looking at the differences.
Very different.
Okay. Well, I guess, you know, when you look at the evolution of Marxism, as I mentioned, the CCP historically had worked very hard to localize Marxism, right? And you have this notion of Marx and Marxian Confucianism in the 1980s, even. And as you know, China opened its door, Marxization really took hold, and Marxism as a kind of as a doctrine has been very much discredited. But on the other hand, the Chinese state still does not want to give up on this because they have yet to find something that can replace this kind of a central party doctrine. So they again wanted to modernize, and I will use this term, modernize Marxism, right? And how to make, centuries ago, political economists be relevant to this contemporary Chinese society. And so, but, you know, again, this is the question of, you know, whether you can reconcile, as you said, they are fundamentally different. But on the other hand, you know, Marxism as practiced in China in the past decades has very much absorbed Confucianism. You know, in many ways, for instance, I can give you a few based on my understanding. You know, I'm not an expert by all by any means, but you know, both I think Marxism and Confucianism really put welfare rights over human rights, right? So what's fundamental is the socioeconomic welfare rather than, you know, the kind of to them, the what we understood in the West as a human rights, freedom of speech, right, the right to express yourself, and these are secondary to the kind of economic welfare. So that's one. I think too that this is actually touched upon by the students we interviewed, and as they elaborate, the Confucianism really emphasizes the rule of not law, but a benevolent wise ruler. So the concept of wise ruler, right? Benevolent ruler, benevolent individual. And these, so the wise ruler in a Confucian sense and the state as an authority in the Marxist sense share, you know, the same kind of traits in many ways, right? So that's another kind of a fusion point. So what might be the other kind of a point of you know, dialogue and emerge? Well, there's a, you know, kind of a very interesting dynamic between individual rights and collective rights. You know, again, so in, as Marxism as practiced in China has emphasized this kind of a collective rights, an individual would benefit from contributing to the collective well-being. So there are places actually, you know, the two actually talk to each other. The two actually, you know, can seamlessly merge, and which is what actually the students didn't really address in this documentary. But
what is interesting is traditionally you look at those students who are, you know, from poor family, from very remote villages. They still have the opportunity to go to the best university in China through the traditional, pretty much the state exam system.
Right, education really does bring mobility.
Yeah, so yeah. They really still have the execution of so-called merit or meritocracy, the brightest rise through the educational system, which is nationally all to the top. And so they are considered themselves as elite. And then, you know, in the time that China is facing so much changes, the whole world is changing. And I think it's very easy for the elite, intellectual elite, to kind of retreat to Confucianism. It's a very easy way because you find a safe haven in that, where you look at the outside world, pretty much they will be forgotten, or the world will move forward without them participating. So even this movement of the, I don't know how representational they are in terms of among all the Chinese youth who are so Chinese intellectuals studying a doctoral program. You know, when they went to Kongling, Confucius, it was amazing that you shot it in a way that is hardly anybody. But actually, it's a very, very busy, extremely commercialized, probably the most visible.
It's a tourist attraction, yes.
In China. So we saw some of the commercialism there, but it's just that you shoot it like nobody else is there except her. And it was like you're going to the National Palace Museum or the palace, the interior, the palace in China. In Beijing, and you shoot it's nobody else. No, it's just like it's as busy as New York Street. So you know, you deliberate, but nevertheless, it's a very commercialized sign.
I think that's part of this kind of dynamic the documentary tries to capture.
Take on that, but you know, in the end, it comes out. They buy these extremely big, huge insect sticks that probably. cost them a limb and an arm. And then it was this guy. So within the film, it posed very, very interesting question. Even those Chinese intellectuals raised for themselves. It's kind of also China's question in this vast commercialization. Where's the safe haven? Even Confucius probably won't be the safe haven.
I think the question I have for go ahead.
Question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is being poor really a common perception among the intellectual elites? I mean, do they really think collectively that they are poor? I mean, like here in the United States, we have intellectual elites, but they don't think they're poor. I mean, if I see them, probably I judge them as poor, but I mean, I'm not rich, but, you know, being doctors, and I say, oh, your doctor is still living in an apartment. And, I'd say he's poor, but he might not think of himself as poor. I mean, that's what I want to know from, Chinese. And in, you know, and in connection with that, you know, I'm a student. I'm still a student of Chinese history, and I just enjoy it. Except that I'm sort of surprised that, you know, in every period of its dynasties, right, that there's always the emergence of the aristocrats. Yeah. Is there an emerging new aristocratic elite in China after Mao?
I'm not sure, I guess, that what is there a question there?
Well, I'm surprised that they didn't address it. I mean, after the revolution. I mean, that situation.
Go ahead.
Rising. Because every dynasty has sort of actually addressed that situation, except that the aristocrats have always been resilient. What's the solution to that situation?
He's an intellectual aristocrat. They're not really inherited their position, but it's through their school education. The state educational system that they got picked, they transcend themselves within the system to get.
You know, actually, what I want to say to I agree with what you observed. These students, a lot of the confusion and anxiety stem from the fact that once they get out of school, there's no job there.
Yeah.
There's no job there. Unlike, you know, a decade ago in the 1990s, there's plenty of job. You know, China was on the rise, and there's a double-digit economic growth and so on. The financial crisis here has really damped development in China, too. So we're really talking about a group of Chinese students. These are, you know, they spend all these years to study and obtain a seat in mostly the Chinese university, but once they get out, there's no job market for them. So that is the reality they're confronting. I don't think, you know, this is a kind of a rich man's entertainment, amusing philosophically. No. They're facing a very stark economic reality here. And they themselves are not rich by no means. Yes?
No, one of the things I was going to say is I think this happens with all societies when they start to get into an industry or modernization or whatever you want. Because, I mean, I have family from the islands, okay, Trinidad, Grenada, etc. And in Trinidad, what they started doing was they were educating a lot of the students, but the whole thing was once the students were educated and they had these graduate degrees and college degrees, there was no place for them to work because, like you said, you know, it's an agricultural society, it's a society of civil servants. So where do these people go? So what happens to me, what I see, is that in every country, those people start leaving. And there's a migration out because they want to go, if they can't find something where they are, they're going to go where they can, where they feel they can be compensated for the education that they have. And so it becomes a brain drain, so those people no longer contribute to the society in a large way. You know, because I've seen a lot of, I've met a lot of students who are graduate students here. And I asked them, I said, are you going back to China? And they tell me, hell no.
What is a Chinese student right there?
I would go back.
No, but I'm saying he's one. But I'm saying I've met a bunch of them in journalism, in other fields, and they're not going back. Because they're like, what are they going to go back to?
I think I should, you know, think the you know, aspects of, well, part of what we've captured in this documentary really is, you know, common to, you know, the young students or young intellectuals, you know, not rich intellectuals, let's put it that way, and everywhere, not just in China. You know, this is, a common, a very common dilemma facing and confronting to the newly educated youth. So, you know, what triggered me, because nobody has asked the question, why did you go into China and make this documentary?
Three years
total. Yeah, pre-production started in 2010. Actually, I wanted to thank my daughter, and she was with me in China. The first book club meeting we went to, and she was with me. That was back in 2010, and production took place in fall 2011, and then post-production took another year in the spring in 2012. So it's a lot of hard work. I literally actually lost quite a few pounds just by going in and shooting and so on. And then the documentary premiered at the Dutch Film Festival only last September, and it was broadcasted in the Netherlands National Television last October. And for what it's worth, it was mentioned as a quality documentary program that National Television, public TV can do during the Netherlands parliamentary debate about funding for Dutch TV. So it's hot labor.
Yeah. And why did you go?
It is a book club or book study.
It's a book club. It's a book club.
Book club. Yeah. Is this type of activity rather common?
You know, I cannot.
The universities, because during the main.
I know Chinese classics learning has become a part of the core components of higher education in China now. I think it started in 2005. I think one of the first ones, one of such classics learning colleges is in Beijing, Renmin University. And it kind of soon proliferated across China in these major universities. But whether these kind of a private book club is very common, I don't have an answer for that. Oh, I'm sorry. You.
Yeah, I'm just
the gentleman over there.
Okay, this is sort of a limited discourse. Certain areas can't be talked about. How much is the self-censorship and how much is, you know...
I don't think it is a, there was not much self-censorship going on. It's not a real sense of, you know... It's not a sensitive topic. The documentary I made a year ago is a very sensitive topic. It's about, the documentary is about Google's China venture, border China venture, which is highly sensitive. But this one, no. There's no overt censorship per se. But whether the students, when they talk to me, whether they pause, And withhold information, withhold thoughts, that's another issue. But it's not a political issue at all. It's a, you know, very wide debate in China. Traditional modernity, that, like, you know, the kind of a dichotomy between, yeah.
I'm just wondering, the fact that it was conducted in the professor's private home, could it be that the universities do not allow that?
No.
I'm sorry, who?
And then could it be that the universities do not allow that kind of a club exist on?
Oh, no. Nobody is regulating these kind of clubs.
They are not interested to register as an association. That's a part that you can, the government won't allow you. You want to register as an association.
Well, the government would be very happy if all you do is go home and study instead of going to the street and demonstrate.
In a school, right, if you just meet regularly without having independent association or independent NGO, it's fine.
You
can do whatever you want.
I went into China somewhat feeling, you know, it was cynical, but I left China when I was really moved by these students, that they're genuinely, very sincerely is looking for answers for this, you know, a cluster of social ills that's plaguing China today. And the kind of a determination, I would say tenacity. I mean, these are not easy tasks, I have to say. I was sitting there, and half of the time, I don't know what they were talking about. I couldn't understand these traditional Chinese texts. I couldn't understand. But they were there. A lot of them are not Chinese philosophy students. They are Western philosophy students, sociology students, comparative literature students, and so on. It's very moving to me. It's a very interesting personal experience to me.
Yeah, yes? I'm just curious, what's your take from this experience? How do you view these people searching, and how do you view Confucianism after meeting them and went through this experience?
I would say the takeaway would be, let's hold back. Let's don't rush to judgment. Who are way to pass judgment? These kids who live there, that's the reality. It's confronting them, and they have to sort it out themselves. I'm not there to passing on my own judgment, my own understanding of what Confucius is. I grew up in a different era. I grew up, coming of age in the 1960s, 1970s, when Confucius was considered, Confucianism was considered as the enemy of modernization and revolutionary spirit. So I came in, my understanding of Confucianism was just different. And this is actually a very interesting discovery for myself as well. Oh, okay, that's interesting, original text. Okay, the notion of, benevolent ruler, maybe, there might be something said about it. But then again, I'm not the one who is to pass on the final verdict. And this is a very, very controversial issue. Let's just put it this way.
I'm asking more about your sense, your feelings. I'm asking for your judgment.
I just shared with you my feeling that I don't feel like, I'm in this position to really... I suppose, not necessarily judgment, but there's nothing, this is not a black and white issue. I certainly see the validity of this kind of search, and I'm very moved by this kind of search. But in the end, this is the question of the China model, and that's another, huge question. So what is the China model, the essence of China model? And also it goes back to really a century-old same issue, westernization, modernization, like this gentleman mentioned earlier, right? And it's as if we're back to, the very early era in the 1920s, right?
In the text, you say that the Confucius family up until Qing Dynasty is buried there. I think they were, from my understanding and interpretation of the trend, the last one, Kong Decheng, went to Taiwan, And I think he's highest deputy leading man, master leading man. After he died, his family, he wished to be buried in China, in the Shandong, Confucius hometown,
right.
Because he was conversion secretary,
right.
And agreed that he was, his body was returned through Hong Kong, and then returned to where he's supposed to be buried. So I believe even Confucius, the nearest descendant, even after he died, will be also shipped back to China and buried right in the burial ground.
Sure, yeah. Well, it's amazing when we visited Kongling. It was just an amazing experience. And to answer actually the question you mentioned, how come and nobody else was there? Because we had to get up super early to capture, you know, we're really getting up, it was, I guess, 4 o'clock in the morning, because we wanted to be able to really film before the, you know, hordes of tourists get there, because we'll be, you know, we'll be unable to do it. So it has nothing to do with it. Perspective point of view, it really is logistics of filming.
Oh.
This is what the reality.
And it's wonderful to see it on the film. There's nobody else there.
There's a blue tinge. Yeah, I think it's a somewhat very romanticized depiction of a group of Chinese students and their search and so on and so forth. I think it reflects very much my collaborators' sensibility and partly mine, but mostly their sensibility. And so, you know, to me, it's really, you know, it's a film beautifully shot, beautifully put together, very interesting music. I might not.
Why are you choosing the Crouching Tigers?
You know, it's not my choice. It's not my call. I'm not the post production. You know, I probably would have chosen something that's less kind of heavy handed. But that, you know, really reflects its production team, reflects the choice of the
music, right?
Yeah, it's but it certainly, you know, it speaks volume, though. It speaks volume in many ways, not necessarily mine, but well, I hope you enjoyed it. I have to wrap it up and.